Thank you for that introduction, Ben. Talking about discovering new ones, we found a new one just yesterday, new fish just yesterday. And it was about that big. I looked at it and thought, that's new. So, sure enough, anyway, I was going to get you to, it's going to come off. How many of you grew up with Sesame Street, kids with Sesame Street? No one's admitting it, very few of you. I was kind of thinking, shall I get you singing this song? But that's probably a bridge too far, really. So instead, I'm going to pose a question. Is it too much? Okay, if you're a scientist studying a living thing, that can be an animal, plant, bacteria, fungi, virus is living? Probably. There are two very essential questions you have to ask yourself as you start your investigation. Failure to ask these questions or getting the answer wrong can completely screw up all your research. What do you think those two questions are? And no pressure, kids get it right first time every time.
Is it alive?
Close. What?
Is it alive?
No, we've already said it's a living thing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, okay. You're close, yeah? Come on, don't be shy. I don't bark.
Is it different?
Is it different? You're ill edging around it. What's its name? Is it different?
What is it?
Yes. The question kids always ask, what's that? What species am I studying? And the second one's a little bit more tricky, so I'll give it to you for free. And how do I tell it apart from things I'd like to make it? Now you may think that's rather basic, but it can be quite easily overlooked with some fairly spectacular results. One of our discoveries quite a few years ago was a species called King Terrakee. And it's a completely different species. And when I pointed this out to colleagues at Niwa, they said, oh, that's why the graphs of this fish species up in the north all did that. Two peaks. We never knew why. It's because you've got two species. You didn't ask these questions. Perhaps the most difficult one was many, many years ago, I was assisting a friend with his PhD, and he got me to talk to the other PhD candidates, talking with one young person who was at the write-up stage of their thesis. They'd done years and hours of work in the field, getting data. What are you studying? Oh, this. Which species is it? And I got the blank look. Oh, there's only one. And I thought, bet you there ain't. You better send some specimens to, and gave them a name. Three species, two genera. And they were conflating all the biological data into that one, into as one species. So the data was immediately skewed in all kinds of ways because neither they nor their supervisor had asked those questions. So, and this is the nuts and bolts of what the museum collection is about. This is why we have them. Answering them is our traditional core business. It's been our core business since mid-1800s, and you go to any other national museum, the Natural History Museum in London, Museum National Histoire Natural in Paris, any of those museums, that is part of their core business as the national institution, and we're actually charged under the Act to hold collections of and do studies on New Zealand's flora and fauna. And we become specialised. This is, and the science is called taxonomy, the science of naming. And this has been a very old science. It's not as sexy as it used to be, and it's sometimes considered a bit of a soft science. But when I see ecologists and gel jockeys doing it, they make the most appalling botch-ups and create all kinds of problems for us. We use specimens for our descriptions. I mean, there's a bit of a push now, can't you use photographs? Can't you use eDNA? No, you can't. And the example I give is, I can look at a specimen, our oldest specimen in the collection from 1869. When that fish was collected, x-rays were not a standard thing. And yet within a handful of years, by the turn of the century, you could x-ray a specimen and you could look inside it without having to cut it up to see how many vertebrae it's got. You could, by the mid part of the 20th century, electron microscopes could take you right in tight. I remember years ago when I was first at university, my biochemistry lecturer came in to give his lecture. He was just about skipping. He was so excited he had to can the lecture to tell us all that the lab just down the corridor from his office had just sequenced a protein. And now I'm writing gene bank for DNA sequences to put together trees. So you can go back to these old specimens and look at them again and again and again with new scientific knowledge and new tools. So that's why we hold specimens. We provide identification to across a whole range of organisms to a whole range of organisations. We're seen as neutral. Whatever personal feelings I might have, say, towards the seafood industry, if they ask me a question, they get the answer. Whether it's the seafood industry as an extractor, the environmental organisations as a protector, or government as a legislator, we stand neutral in the information that we give. And in terms of knowing what the species is, because we are being confronted with an absolute, I won't say tsunami, but it just seems to be never ending intake of invasive species. If we know what the species is, then we can recommend what actions can be taken. And we'll come to some of these in a moment. Some of them are best neutral, some of them have got quite a few of us worried. We've had some 30 marine and freshwater species have arrived here through human mediation. So we have three legs on our stool to provide taxonomic expertise. The first is the collection, and I'm going to unashamedly focus on fishes because that's my thing. We have close on 62,000 registered lots. Over 250,000 specimens. Now that's the biggest collection in New Zealand. It sounds impressive. My wonderfully entertaining and mad Scots friend who was at Texas A&M said, that's about the size of my collection. That's a teaching collection. We'll get on to that because we blow a lot of people out of the water. The Burke Museum in Washington State has over 1 million registered lots. We have 43,000 odd jars, just of fishes. Across the entire collection, we have 91,000 jars. What's that?
Put that in your pocket.
Ranging up to 2 litres. We have over 1,120 litre drums for the intermediate sized specimens, over 2,000 across all collections. And this is where we blow people out of the water. We have 171 tanks. Now, when we bring in an overseas visitor, particularly one from one of the big American institutions, they're very impressed with our collection, but you get the feeling they're a little bit sort of patronising the collection. And we take them and show them the tanks, and then we have to lift their bottom jaw off the floor. It is the biggest collection of large specimens in the world. Bigger than the Smithsonian or any of the other better funded institutions. We're growing about 1,200 specimens of fish a year. And our primary focus is, first of all, the New Zealand Economic Zone exclusive continental shelf, the Southern Ocean, in particular the Ross Dependency, out into the Pacific, and then elsewhere. So this is where we are, the top of Tory Street, not Cable Street, the Shire, Mordor. The Shire, Mordor. Okay. It's the old City Works building. It's right next to Pukeahu War Memorial Park. We have just been told by the government that they have agreed to fund us a serious amount of money to build our new facility because it's no longer compliant. We're under a notification from WorkSafe around the way in which the building has been built for holding our specimens. So these are our jars on lovely shelves open to allow firefighting foam to get in if there's a fire. So far, we've had a couple of close calls with foam release, but it had nothing to do with fire. It had to do, in one case, security guard being a bit of a dick. Thankfully, it wasn't in this room. But the jars, and for weight reasons, we keep the foams on the bottom shelf. And these are the tanks. Most museums call a 250 litre tank their largest tank. We call it our smallest. So we have 50 of those and 127 of those 500 litre half ton tanks. And this is where WorkSafe gets upset, because we have grossly exceeded our maximum permissible volume of alcohol. But wait, there's more. We have these are our monster bins, as we call them. And our largest is 3,350 litres. I have my biggest specimen is a 3 metre, 400 kilogram sleeper shark. We have a Queensland groper, 115 kilos, the largest intact Queensland groper anywhere in the world. We have colossal squid, giant squid, turtles, quarter ton manta rays, quarter ton sunfish, and giant undescribed deep water skates. The second leg of the stool is the literature, and we have an extensive library, and it goes from 1738. Peter Artigi, have any of you heard of him? Who's heard of Carl Linnaeus?
Yeah.
Okay, everyone knows Carl Linnaeus. Well, there's some school of thought that says that Peter Artigi was the one who actually developed the binomial system, and the Linnaeus nicked it. Artigi came to a very sticky end, or a sad end, or a strange end. He was walking home from a dinner party one night drunk and fell on the canal and drowned. And he was only in his early 30s. But I then need to actually, we have a hard copy on the shelf of his book, probably worth several thousand dollars. I had cause to actually access it and go through it when we were looking at describing the new species of sunfish to see whether or not he'd got to it first. And the latest was a paper I printed out today on some deep water star eaters, they're called. And the third leg is knowledge. And this is where it gets really tricky. My friend Wendy Nelson, who's NIWA's senior scientist and one of the top people in the world studying algae, has said to me that she considers taxonomy to have the longest apprenticeship of any science. When you finish your university, you've got your shiny new PhD, and you go out and, fingers crossed, you get a job in the field that you've studied and worked so hard to work in. There's an apprenticeship period where you learn to apply what you've learned across a really broad spectrum. With taxonomy, it's at least a decade. And that comes down to just basically looking at the same thing again and again and again until you can look at something and go, that's not quite like the other ones. And I've had that time and again where I've gone back years later and gone, I know what that is now. Because the problem is that colour can vary with age and sex and the depth in which something's taken. The shape can vary with sex, juveniles to adults. Thin ray counts, that can be variable, some conservative, some very broad. You've got relevant and dodgy and outdated literature. You've got to be able to pick who's the reliable scientist. Who do we trust here? And it simply comes down to experience. So, now we get to the nub of this, alien aquatic incursions. We've had them both in marine and fresh water. You've probably been aware of things like some of the fan worms that have turned up in marinas. We've had the invasive seaweed, Undaria, which has now spread itself all around harbours and relatively sheltered coastal around the country. Most of them, sadly, have had the capacity not only to survive, but spread and thrive, because they arrived, but their principal predator or consumer did not. And that they're spreading because they've formed self-sustaining populations. And there's a varying degree of negative impact. As I said earlier, the best we can sort of hope for is neutral. But in most cases, there seems to be a strong negative impact of some kind. And over the last 30 years, we've had 148 of these arrive and establish. And to my horror, as I was preparing this last year, number 149, and it's a doozy. It was on Radio New Zealand. In Florida, this is called the murder weed. It's a, we have the genus Calerpa here, Rima weed and sea grapes, very pretty seaweeds. But this one, the Floridians call the murder weed. It spreads by stolon spreading out, and if it gets disturbed a little, it breaks off, it just settles to the bottom and starts a new colony. Where this has established, it smothers everything. There are no shellfish, there are no lobsters, there are no fish. Just murder weed, and that's it. And unfortunately, this has been found in a couple of little embayments up in the Hauraki Gulf. And they're not sure how do we handle this. We can't just go in there and start ripping it out willy-nilly, because we'll break off little bits, they'll float off in the current, and next thing it pops up everywhere. This was one that came from a drain in the Bay of Plenty. Anyone keep tropical fish? The plecs, as they're called, are an algae-eating catfish. And when they're small, they're really good because they'll move along your plants, and they'll move along your glass, and they'll scrape off all the green slime weed that grows there. Great, you think, fantastic. And then they grow up and they become like teenagers. They just hang around the house and don't like what you've cooked and foul the tank because they poop like mad. And what do you do with them? Well, the owner of this particular specimen let it go in the drain. Now, this is one of the fastest spreading freshwater invasive fishes in the world. It's causing a huge problem in parts of the world where the temperature is warm enough to support a breeding population. So far, we've only got the one. The big trouble with these things, well, there are several problems. The first is they burrow into banks to form brood chambers, so they're very hard to actually get. The second thing is you can probably gather from the scales, they're armored, and they've got strong spines that they can lock out. And what's happened overseas is fish and birds and even alligators have attempted to eat them. These things have panicked, locked their spines, and both have died. There's only been one river in which they've been successfully eradicated. It was a relatively clear river, and it took teams of volunteer divers 2 or 3 years of just snorkeling up and down with spear guns, spearing them. These grow to around about 28 centimetres long. So you can imagine a shag thinking, I've got an easy meal here because they're not fast swimmers, and shag dies. But the risk of this at the moment is fairly moderate because our water temperatures and our seasonal temperatures still drop too low to support a self-sustaining population. People who keep these, who breed catfish, it's all done with a heated tank. So we're trying to persuade them that if they get too big, you don't want them anymore, take them back to the pet shop or euthanize them. Put them in a bag, put them in the freezer, euthanize them. Don't let them go. This one was much more serious. Some of you will have heard of the notorious Stewart Smith. Stewart Smith, there was an article on him in the paper, and there was a podcast on him. He was an English immigrant, an avowed socialist, working class lad, who's growing up, he had a very poor life, and growing up his one joy and escape from the misery of poverty was to go fishing, coarse fishing they call it in the UK. And coming out to New Zealand, he decided what he wanted to do was to give New Zealand children the opportunity to have the pleasure that he had. So his aims were quite noble. Trouble was, he was introducing English coarse freshwater fish. So we have rudd everywhere, courtesy of Stewart Smith. He even modified his his little station wagon to have tanks and airstones, and he would travel around the country like a demented Johnny Appleseed, liberating these bloody fish in ponds and rivers everywhere. Now, somehow he was getting support from other people, because somebody bought in Marum lobster from Australia. Now, the MPI considered introducing these in a controlled fashion for aquaculture and decided their escape risk was too high, and if they got out, they'd just devastate everything in our waterway. Well, one day a young lad in Auckland, down the road from where Stewart had his garage, his workshops, came across a lobster walking on the footpath. And he went and told his dad, and his dad said, "Don't be a bloody idiot, son." And they went out together, and sure enough, there it was. Stewart had somehow or other scored some marrow and had tank after tank after tank full of these damn things breeding. He also had tank after tank after tank of the European gudgeon. But worse than that, we know that he has liberated them into at least one pond. That pond was pumped dry and everything in it killed, and several buckets of fish sent down to us for identification. So here it is here. If he managed to liberate that into the Waikato River or any of the other river systems, it will be seriously detrimental to both our native plants, freshwater plants, and our native invertebrates. It will outcompete our native freshwater fish, and it'll just smother them in terms of sheer numbers. I don't know why he introduced it, but when he gets about that big, you know, you'd have to use a very small hook to catch it, and then so what? You feed it to a cat or something. So it is extremely high as both a predator and a competitor. We are hoping that that's the last we see of them. We've always kept it on our books. Stewart had his tank seized and broken after that. So how do they things get here by themselves? Well, ballast water is the traditional way in which people seem to think things get here. So discharging cargo, you want to keep your ship fairly low on the waterline, so you take in water to add weight, but you're taking in also the larvae and the eggs of other things. And you might have an empty or partly empty cargo hold. You arrive at your destination, you start loading, you do an exchange of your ballast water, and round and round and round it goes. Now, ballast is pretty hostile. It's hot, it's rusty, it's nasty, but amazingly, things survive in it. So there's around about 15 billion tons of ballast being carried by ships every year from one port to another. And it could just be going from Auckland to Wellington, or it could be going from somewhere in the UK to Australia. And our first recognised ballast transport was in the North Sea in 1903 from an Asian species of phytoplankton. Now there's some ballast being pumped out. But much more likely is this thing. It's called a sea chest. It's a large indentation on the hull of a ship. And it's big enough you and I could sit in that quite comfortably. And its purpose is that it's an area of dead water where, when the ship's traveling at speed, where the ship can draw water from for cooling the engine, for making fresh water, and the like. And it is literally a traveling hotel. So that's one that's 2 cubic meters. And they can get pretty gnarly, as you can see. It's a floating 5-star hotel. That thing is covered with encrusting invertebrates, probably none of them from the port where this thing has been photographed. The only way you can actually clean these is to get in there with a high pressure steam hose and blast it, or dry dock the ship, both of which are very expensive. So here it is here, diagrammatic form. And wharves are great places for things to live. So over that 4-year period, survey of 42 vessels, 150 different organisms were found in their sea chests. And 15% of those were non-native. 35% we don't know where they're from. There's a couple of species of snapper, which aren't native to New Zealand. that have both been captured here. The top one was caught off North Cape, the bottom one was speared by a sparrow in 2010. Now these, we know that they had to be assisted over here because they don't persist in the larvae long enough for the Trans-Tasman current to carry them here. They've got quite specific short lifestyles as larvae and juveniles, and then they settle out. So the risk for these establishing kind of low, because you actually need a decent population, and how much they would compete with our snapper species, don't really know. A lot of these tropical snappers actually need seagrass beds to complete their life cycle on. This is the record holder. This is the barred knife fish. Now, a pair of these are now, have been for quite some time, scuba diving attractions in Valencia Harbour, Malta. Their native habitat is Japan. And this particular species has gotten all around the world. It is really adept at getting up and getting around. They've turned up in California. They've come across the Pacific, associated with rubbish from Fukushima and tsunami. Okay, and then 24th of April, I get a panic call from a harbour master. A very large motor yacht had been sailing around Tahiti, came doodling down the New Zealand coast and slipped at Auckland. And he said, "We've got buckets of live fish from the sea chest." Several 20 litre buckets of live fish found in the sea chest. So we got Tom Trinsky from the Auckland Museum to go down and pick them up for us. 12 species of common reef fish, squirrel fish, surgeon fish, banner fish, and the like. My question is, how many slipped out of the sea chest as the ship was tootling along the coast? Now, these are quite specific requirements for very warm tropical reefs. They could probably survive here very easily, but chances of them forming a population really low, unless our sea is significantly warm, which we don't want. But that gives you some idea of the volume of material that can come in. Our estuary gobies and dart gobies. This is the really interesting one. So these rather pretty little fish are found mostly around Northland. And this one was described from Russell, Bay of Islands, in the 1800s. They are all Australian species, except for top one, which is the Japanese species, which has turned up in Australia and now turned up here. That one with the red star was actually described from New Zealand. It probably came over as in amongst fouling on sailing ships, because we know Russell was a service hub. The sealers and whalers and all kinds of people that come, that rock up, was called the hellhole of the South Pacific. It was such a rough place. But nobody really appreciated the need to have your hull scrubbed. The big problem there wasn't I'm bringing nasty stuff, it was ship's worm has eaten my ship to death. So they weren't actually concerned. So this one has turned up and is now established from here. And gobies are ideal candidates. They have got themselves all around the world. They are as tough as boots. They can tolerate really foul water conditions. They can tolerate very low oxygen conditions, and they breed like flies. And the risk potential is moderate to high, both as a predator and a competitor. Now this next one has really got MPIs, and it is. We published on this just a couple of months ago. My colleague Clive, who lives up in Nungaroo, has been helping a local farmer, landowner, who's got this large wetland, which he wants to preserve and conserve and restore. No cheers from Russell. As part of that, he's got walkways over it, so people, you know, raised wooden walkways so people don't trample the plants down. And half a day a year, the local primary school kids come out and he takes them through and he talks about the plants, he talks about how important wetlands are. and the like. So he got Clive just to come along and say, talk about the fish. So they set some traps, and they got an aquarium full of little fish, usual suspects, eels, galaxids, cockabullies. And Clive sent me an email going, what the hell is this, Andrew? And I said, it's something new, mate. And it turned out to be this thing, mangrove goby. We got three specimens, two males and a female. And on iNaturalist, it appears that this thing is spread all around Northland now. The big trouble with this one is, it's not that big. It's only about 3 centimetres long. Its sister species, which lives in the same place as Platinotus, has made it over to Hawaii. And in the waterways where it is established, it has wiped out all other fish species and most of the invertebrates, native invertebrates. They are voracious predators, and they are incredibly fecund breeders. So now MPI is twitching because they're wanting to run surveys up there, and I'm saying you're going to have to wait until summer because it's just a bit too gnarly. We're going to get into the mangroves, which is a very, very difficult area to work in. You're up to your waist in mud. The water is the colour of mushroom soup. How are we going to do this? In the meantime, it seems as though it's been picked up from as far north as Whangarei all the way almost to Auckland. So it's here, it's probably been here a while, and it's probably spread like that in just a few years. Okay, I have to preface this one with some background information. 2002, cell phone did not come with cameras. And in fact, digital cameras were a fairly new thing that not very many people had. And I got a call from the weighmaster of a fishing competition in Dunedin. Now, I don't know if any of you are recreational anglers or take part in fishing competitions, but some of the prizes are frighteningly good. You know, a brand new four-wheel drive boat and trailer for the largest yellowfin tuna lander, stuff like that. And this guy in a fishing competition in Dunedin had landed a fish alive and was claiming the most unusual prize. So the weighmaster smelled a rat and he said to me, if I trace round it and fax it to you, could you identify it? Yeah, okay. So can you find a digital camera while you're doing all this? Yeah, we're looking. So anyway, this fax comes off the machine and I look at it and someone's pulling my leg, someone is having a laugh. So he rings me back. Did you get it? Yes. We've got a digital camera. Great. I said, right. Photograph the head and the mouth, please. Inside the mouth. He sends them through. Yep. So where did he say he caught it? Oh, about an hour's steam from the Otago Heads. Really, I said. Tell him to sell his hull design for the America's Cup defense team. Why? Because it's only found in the Orinoco Basin in Amazon. It's piranha. He had a tank of the damn things in his garage and decided to get rid of one of the larger ones. So the police were involved. He was trying to defraud a fishing competition. Doc were involved. Noxious pest without a permit. He wasn't allowed to have it. It was all going to go to court and everything, so he coughed in the end, confessed, and thankfully, the fish were seized and destroyed. I had a subsequent one from a police drugs raid in Otago, in Dunedin. The officer took a photograph and sent it through to me. Is this a piranha? I said, go back and kill them and bring me one. Turned out it was a paku, which he was allowed to have. But telling the two apart, you've got to look at the teeth. The piranha have got these serrated teeth like a great white, whereas paku have got sort of pointed teeth for crushing fruit. So, we're going to have incursions as long as we've got international shipping and idiots. Einstein once said, only two things are infinite, universe and human stupidity, and I'm not sure about the universe. We can do something about the former, the latter less so. We should be, perhaps, and I will be, I have been talking with MPI about requiring vessels at sea to actually regularly backflush their sea chests with hot water. I want to avoid using chemicals, but if you put scalding hot water through, that will kill anything that's in there. What we don't want is you know, some of these other things like the Mediterranean fanworm and some of these salts are just choking up everything in some of the harbours. So I said sea chests are probably more than ballast water. It's a much more benign environment for anything that's getting around. And sadly, it's making New Zealand more, climate change is making it more accessible to invasive species. You may have been aware that the kids used to have the red-eared terrapins, turtles, as pets. They're now banned in Auckland. Because people, you get them, they're that big, they're cute. And by the time they're this big, they're about as dynamic as a piece of wood. They bite you, they can give you salmonella, they're really gross animals, they stink. So rather than euthanize them, people let them go. And they are breeding. At the moment, it's still cold enough that only males are being produced. But if it warms up enough that females start being produced, then we're going to have a very serious problem, not only like possums in the waterway.
They had one in Manu.
I'm not surprised. Hopefully it's... The thing is, these things are going to live 60, 70 years. So I'd just like to acknowledge my colleagues who helped me with this and over the time, and ask if you've got any questions.
Yeah.